The term identification usually for archaeologists and art historians, especially with reference to temples, it would seem it is related to the stylistic identification like Nagara, Dravida, Vesira or Hoysala, Chola, Chalukya, so on and so forth. But here I am not using the term in that sense. I am trying to emphasize on identifying a temple as a heritage monument. As we know, in India we have innumerable heritage sites which are serving as tourist spots too. And earlier, as one of my senior friend was telling, though we get information regarding, you know, how to reach the destiny or reach the place, we do not know the root of that place. Why does it become historically important? Why is it important? How is it important? So basically, we have to identify a building as a heritage monument based on some norms. And then historical evaluation. We proudly talk about the amount of structures, heritage buildings we have in India. But it is unfortunate that majority of them are not recognized as historical structures at all. So, some time ago, there are some people who usually, while conversing with me, they tell the Westerners have a lot of historical consciousness. They do conserve their structures. They tell there is some, you know, a railway station or some library which was built in 1857. They have a board, they have, you know, preserved it in a very technical manner. But the problem we have basically in India is, you travel 10 kilometers, we pass about 15-20 monuments minimum. It is too much for one single government or some one association to take care of. So naturally we see only the important spots, important temples identified as World Heritage Sites. There be more emphasis is laid only on them, and it's there only being spoken about. But there are equally important structures spread all over the place, and they are losing their original form today for various reasons. So in the course of my talking, I'll handle both the identification as well as the historical evaluation, how it has to be done. See, in this first slide, I am showing you the Virupaksha temple from Pattadakal. Pattadakal is one of the world famous temple of Chalukyan, early Chalukyan architecture. And any historical research related with art and architecture would start from this temple, at least in Karnataka. So any reference, we usually say the earliest reference of some pillar or some prakara or some shikara, whatever, the earliest references we turn towards this temple, which is in Pattadakal. And as already been spoken by many people now, Pattadakal is a well-known tourist center. Next slide. So this is Hindukya. This is yet another temple in the same Pattadakal complex. Next. Nilsi. This is a twin temple found in a place called Begur, which is very near to Bangalore. If you observe, it is not less in any way to the earlier temples which you saw, which are recognized in a global level as World Heritage Sites. These temples, as a personal experience, when I visited first some 15-20 years ago, it belonged to a village amidst a lot of agriculture fields, and you know, in its own grandeur. But today, in the name of urbanization, the entire Begur is becoming an extension layout of Bangalore city. So there are no more agricultural fields and nothing. Once the population is increasing there, what we observe is, nobody knows these two temples as a heritage monument. It is a temple as old as 10th century. The earliest inscription found dates back almost to 980 AD. So it's a temple which is surviving for the past 1,100 years in this place. But unfortunately of late, as it is in the urban limitation, it doesn't fall under our central archaeology or whatever, and the Mujrai department favors it. So naturally we feel a lot of additions are being made to the temple. Additions are necessary to serve the pilgrims and visitors, that is true. But when it has to be made, it has to be done in a very proper way. I think this point also came in the earlier one of the lectures presented. First of all, a Mujrai or any tourist person, when they are dealing with heritage sites, they must take the advice of some experienced historians or art historians regarding the monument. How are the additions done? The additions are usually done to the whims and fancies of the donors. There is some person who suddenly, you know, he gains devotion regarding the temple. He wants to do something to the temple. And in the reality, if you see, that is harming the structure than protecting. That's where we have to evaluate it historically. That is what I mean by historical evaluation here. What is the antiquity of the temple? How it has to be, you know, retained its original form? That is very essential. Because today we have world famous pilgrim centers in India. We will take Tirupati for example. Some people may emotionally talk about Tirupati being, you know, it's there from the beginning of Kali Yuga or whatever. Now let us not hinder their emotional beliefs. But when we as historians we look there, we will have some parameter regarding the dating. So we want to take it back to some Pallava period, Chola period. But unfortunately today, Tirupati is so much surrounded with modern buildings and other things. If somebody tells, you know, such architecture survived 3000 years back, a software engineer or somebody who is not aware of these historical facts would believe it. So this change without, you know, the historical evaluation of the building is very harmful. We will not be retaining. It's same in many temple sites which are listed in Tamil Nadu also. Next slide. See, these two shikaras which we are seeing now are from Bego, and I compare it with the earlier two shikaras seen in Patarpur. When talking about, you know, like aspect of this shikara in a very canonical background, that is in a textual background, the Shastra Granthas call this shikara as Mandara and Swastika. Now, suppose there is some person who knows Shastra and wants to teach the student regarding Mandara and Swastika, he will invariably quote only Patadkal, leaving the structures which are very near to us. And some find a, if there is some other rich donor who would want to contribute more to this temple, the shikara itself might lose its morphology completely. And another speciality, I think this will be of more interest to art historians. This particular vimana belongs to the Anarpita class. So Anarpita class is a rare instance which we find in these regions. But again, when you are teaching about Anarpita class and trying to explain, we need to quote examples from some Patadkal or somewhere else. Just not Patadkal, we may go to some other, you know, like the so-called historical centers. But in a very near approach, very near to Bangalore, we have a heritage monument with all these features, and it is not brought to light. It is not known. Next slide. See, this is how it is being maintained inside. The original floor has an application of red oxide, so the stone pavement is not found there. Next. See, this is again painted with various colors. And see, unfortunately, the modern people use oil paints. Every year you paint it with great devotion. More the devotion, more the intricacy is gone. You cannot find the sculpture, you cannot identify it, you cannot read the inscription. In a span of 5-6 years, we see that the entire sculpture, what we had seen 5 years back, would have changed a lot. Next. See, this is another world famous site in Itagi. It is Itagi Mahadeva temple. In Karnataka, they call it as Devalayagala Chakravarti. It is referred to as the emperor of temples in Karnataka. The reason being, it has all the components and features which we usually teach or discuss regarding the Dravidian architecture. But if you see, it has been maintained somewhere in the pre-independent period, or I don't know the exact detail. The upper part of the superstructure, they have added some brick and cement structure, which is very haphazard and it does not suit the original structure at all. And there is nothing wrong in removing it. And if you really want to retain the original glory, they can try to build the same thing. What they are seeing in the lower talas, the same components can be built in the higher talas, and then you taper the prasara and you can keep a kalasha. For that, again, we need to take the help of some texts like our Mayamata, Tantra Samuchaya, because every text on architecture, it also has a patala with Jirnodhara. Jirnodhara is nothing but, you know, like reconstruction of a structure. But today the archaeologists have more attachment to the master's manual when it comes to the reconstruction. And the common people, they go to some tantri or somebody, and he would, you know, like whatever the content, we cannot blame them also. So there should be a link primarily between the archaeologists, archaeology department, and the Gujarat department, so that such mistakes are not committed. Next. This is a closer view of the superstructure. This is another temple near Mysore. It is Varuna. It is again, it's a Ganga monument with many unique features in it. The entire Ramayana tableau is carved on the Valabi part of the temple. But the frequent whitewash, and you can see this superstructure is totally modern. It is of a very, very recent origin. In another few years, we will not know whether it is Ramayana, whether it's a swan, whether it is a kubja or whatever, but you can find some, you know, like projecting moldings throughout inside the limestone. Next. Next. See, it's a closer view. This is another temple, Kottai Venkatramana temple in Bangalore. Hindi. See, this is one scene from Ramayana. It's actually on closer observation, it is Anjaneya bringing back the ring to Rama. But you, as I said, in another few years, you cannot identify it. Next. See, this is again, it is Kottai Venkatramana temple situated in heart of Bangalore. Again, nobody knows Kottai Venkatramana as a heritage building, or no student of architecture would bother to study Kottai Venkatramana, because there are again some unique features which I will show in the further slides. Again, if you see, the superstructure is totally modern construction. They have not even attempted to, you know, like rebuild it in the old fashion. So you don't know how the original superstructure existed. Next slide. See, we can see in the Kottai Venkatramana temple, you have the Kapota path, which is almost attached to some modern masonry structure there. So gradually, for some other facility purpose or whatever in the name of this thing, you will lose the original form of it. For example, you can see that a snake is carved which forms a hook by itself. See, people talk about this, that we saw it in Talakad, Vaidyanatheshwara temple. It is in Sringeri Vidyashankara temple. But we have one in the very heart of Bangalore city. So this is how we have to first identify the antiquity of the structure, and we have to evaluate it historically and try to preserve it. Next. It is from the same temple. See, this is another very special unique feature. Usually we call this type of pillar as a Velakantha Stambha. Even in the heartland of Vijayanagara, we can see only, you know, like the Vyalas projecting on one side or two side or whatever. But here you can see it is projecting on all the four sides. This is a very unique feature, especially for the students of architecture. They must know about it. But how many have projected this place as a, you know, like a heritage site for the students? I am more concerned about the students. Because to any heritage site you visit, we find some people guiding. All the guides, they will be trained on some parameters, and they just concentrate on a few popularly known sculptures, talking about Ramana lifting the Kailasa and talking about the attire or drapery or something like that. But there are yet, you know, like minute features which we have to project and observe. Next. Yeah? Okay. See, this is the Appramaya temple in Madu. This is the original costa niche of the temple. Today they have stuffed some brick into it. Next slide, Torsi. And they have installed a very disproportionate modern image in that niche. The original Chola temple or the Hoysala temple, there was an empty niche, and they have, this is an highly disproportionate, it's not at all, you know, like there is no aesthetic at all in the sculpture. And they have installed in another few years, they will build some more grills around it, it will become a special deity, there will be a queue standing in front of that, and so the original structure will be damaged even further. Next. Next. See, this is a next Hindu. You can see how this is from Nittur. It's the Jain Basadi in Nittur of Tumkur district. You can see the original temple has two additional walls on either side. They have built some storerooms or something for electrical generators or something. So naturally, the storeroom is added to the main shrine wall. In between those two walls, you are able to see this Stambapanjara, which is a very important architectural member. But we find modern structures built in this manner. Next. See the flooring. The flooring is completely granite stones paved. The original floor is last. And while doing the original paving, while redoing this thing, when they are rebuilding it, the naturally the ground level increases. While it increases, the lower portions of the pillar or the sculptures, they will surely get merged into the ground. So you can never identify what it is or what it was. That is. Next. Yes. A few more slides. See, this is again, you know, a Bhuvaneshwari with a tube light. So here you cannot see the intricacy of the structure. Next. This is in Athani Taluk in Belagam district. There, half of the temple is last. Next slide. These are all Kalyani Chalukyan structures. But see, there are so many modern, this thing above it. You can find all the dish and other things over a temple. Inside, if you see, and inside, you can see some, it serves as a cow shed with old wheels and other things tied. Next slide. See, this is again a painting, oil painting. They concentrate on each and every minute detail and paint it with oil paint, which is not necessary. Next. So this is again the return painting, which uses its original thing. Now, if I tell it is an 800-year-old structure or something, it is very difficult for a person to accept it. Next. See, this is a deity. You need a lot of effort and experience to identify it. It cannot be, it's Saraswati. It's in Belaga, Gulbarga. It's in Gulbarga district. Next. See the paint, the pillar. Next. Nidana. See, this is from a place called Gadadim. See, half of it, you see the pillar they have painted. Here it is all tiles. The road, the floor, it is paved with granite. Next. Pilaster. So, see, here you can see this temple is being used for various other purposes. This is again, you know, painting of the relief sculptures. Next for Munduk. This is a Vijayanagara period temple found in Gadadim. It has undergone so much of renovation, but there are some unique features. There are so many unique features which you cannot identify today. Next slide, please. Next to her. See, this is actually a parable which can be used to teach students. Today it is filled with all sorts of wires and all such electric. Next one. This is called as a Mushtibandha Pothika, which was popular during the Hoysala period. If you have to tell that it continued during the Vijayanagara period, this is a very good example. But unfortunately, in another few years, we will not be able to recognize it because they will cover it with some granite slabs. Next. See how much of changes they have added to the original structure. Next. Next person. Here you can see Hindu. Here you can see they have added a copper, a brass plated this thing for the door jams, and again the wall is being painted with oil paint. Next. Next one. See, it is on the Gudamantapa of the temple, there is a syntax tank. So this is a Vijayanagara period temple, which would serve as a very good subject matter for the students. See, when there are some students in Kolar, in and around Kolar you will have so many monuments. You need not take them to Hampi or Belur or Halayapet or somewhere else. In Tumkur, you have Settikere, you have Nalvinikere, you have so many such places. But we have a concept that every person has only go to Belur, Halayapet, Hampi, Badami, Pattadkal to know the architecture of the Gudipalli. Then in this time, Devar Gudipalli, near Kolar, Mudubagi. So basically we should keep into the mind that the original heritage structures, they need to be retained in their original form, and for this purpose surely there should be a link between the Mujrai department and the archaeology department, so that at least in future so in future there will be no such harm done to the original heritage stuff. So this is about my paper. If there are any questions, you
can. Really an excellent paper indeed, because we have been talking about tourism, and you know, we are more talking rather in promoting tourism as a product, but this paper throws a way for, you know, very important pertinent issue of how to conserve the heritage, the historical monument, and what all we are doing in the name of modernity, in the name of our this thing, how we are spoiling the heritage sites. And in Thanjavur Bredeshwara temple also recently we have been there, but see, everything is covered, like, you know, hardly we see sculptures, and there's some kind of paint or something, like, you know, most of the temples they have been painted with different colors, losing the original grandeur of that architectural value. And really this explores various issues where we need to concentrate upon. The last paper of this session is, I didn't open for discussion because I just want the other paper presenter to present. This is also in the similar lines, the conservation part. So Dr. H. Chandrasekhar sir is going to present geoarchaeological